देसी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय। श्रील बलदेव विद्याभूषण की जय। श्रील बलदेव विद्याभूषण थिरोभाव महोत्सव की जय। प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोप गोपी गो श्याम कुंड राधा कुंड गिरि गोवर्धन की जय। समवेत भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री गुरु गौरांग की जय। नमो ओम विष्णु पादाय कृष्ण प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। साधु साधु हरे कृष्ण। सो टुडे इज 228th डिसअपीयरेंस डे ऑफ श्रील बलदेव विद्याभूषण। ही अपियर्ड इन 1700 एंड डिसअपीयर्ड इन 1793। सो देयरफॉर इट इज 228th। He was born in Orissa near Remuna in Balesore district, and in childhood he studied in a Gurukula there. So he studied Vyakarna, Nyaya, Mimamsa, Kavya, etc. So then he went to Mysore. You all know Mysore is in Karnataka here. So there he studied in a Madhva Math and later took sannyas. And after taking sannyas, he traveled all over India preaching Madhva's philosophy. So then he came to Jagannath Puri, and there he met Radha Damodar Dev Goswami. So this Radha Damodar Dev Goswami was a great grand disciple of Shyamanand Pandit. You all know Shyamanand Pandit, Shyamanand Prabhu. He was a famous, after Goswamis, six Goswamis, three famous acharyas were there in Gaudiya Sampradaya: Narottam Das Thakur, Srinivas Acharya and Shyamanand Pandit. So in the line of Shyamanand Pandit, he was a acharya in 1700s. This Radha Damodar Dev Goswami. Then he, when Baladev Vidyabhushan met Radha Dev Damodar Goswami, he said, he taught him, means he introduced him to Sandarbhas of Jiva Goswami. So Jiva Goswami, we all know that he wrote six monumental books called Sandarbhas. They are thematic presentation of Srimad Bhagavatam. First one, they are all together, they are called as Bhagavata Sandarbha. And first one are Shad Sandarbhas. Shad means six. So Bhagavat Sandarbha or Shad Sandarbha. First one is Tattva Sandarbha, which establishes how Srimad Bhagavatam is the topmost pramana, topmost Vedic literature. There is no Vedic literature which is superior to Srimad Bhagavatam. Then Bhagavat Sandarbha. All together are called as Bhagavat Sandarbha, but the second one is Bhagavat Sandarbha. And third one is Paramatma Sandarbha. Fourth one is Krishna Sandarbha. Fifth one is Bhakti Sandarbha, and sixth one is Preeti Sandarbha. So like this, first four basically, first one is Pramana, and then three are Sambandha Jnana, and fifth one is Abhideya, and sixth one is Prayojana. So in this way, these four Sandarbhas are presented. And we see that, so Jiva Goswami Sandarbhas, and he also wrote a Krama Sandarbha. It is a verse by verse commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam. And almost all the verses of Srimad Bhagavatam he commented verse by verse. Of course, there is another Krama Sandarbha which is called as a Laghu Krama Sandarbha or something like that. So this broader commentary, it is called as Brahat Krama Sandarbha. So Laghu Krama Sandarbha is only on 10th canto. Some additional, I think later he composed additional so commentary on the verses of 10th canto. So, and these Sandarbhas are very philosophical in nature. Basically other acharyas like Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, they were more into, they discussed more of rasa vichara in the sense bhakti and devotional sentiments to Krishna, and very advanced levels of bhakti. So all those things. So these Sandarbhas basically they are into comparative philosophy, etc., with other Sandarbhas. Anyway, so when Radha Damodar Goswami introduced these Sandarbhas to Balai Vidyabhushan, and he was very inspired, and then he wanted to learn all that from Radha Damodar Goswami. So the Radha Damodar Goswami taught him Sandarbhas. Then after teaching him, he advised him to go to Vrindavan and study Srimad Bhagavatam under Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. So that time Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur was very famous Gaudiya Acharya. So then Balai Vidyabhushan comes to Vrindavan. Then there he studies Srimad Bhagavatam under Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur also has written a commentary on Bhagavatam called Sararta Darshini. So Darshini means reveals. That which reveals the essential meanings, that is called as Sararta Darshini. His commentary on Bhagavad Gita is called as Sararta Varshini, that which showers the essential meanings. So like that there are different so commentaries on. So he has written commentary on Bhagavatam. So he taught him Bhagavatam. That another famous incident happens, that there was a issue, conspiracy or one issue, that Ramanandis are a North Indian sect of Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya. So Ramananda in 14th or 15th century, around in 15th century, he is from Sri Vaishnava, but he preached in North India and he spread this Sampradaya in North India. But it's a little bit deviation from actual Ramanuja Sampradaya. But anyway, they were very, they had a very strong hold in your North India, and especially in Jaipur Kingdom. So there is one place called Amber Valley in Jaipur, near Jaipur. That time Jaipur was not at built actually. So Amber used to be the capital of that Rajasthan kingdom, kings. So there they were basically concentrated, this Ramanandi sect, and they had a stronghold on the kings of Rajasthan also. So everyone practiced Vaishnavism according to their sampradaya in that area. So now also we can see them. Ramanand is there, still there. Few years back I went to that Amber Valley. Actually, I was staying in one devotee's house in Jaipur, and that devotee wanted me to take to Amber Valley, this this center where center of this Ramanand is. That time I could not remember where I have heard read about Amber Valley. Then when I went and I saw that it was, oh, this Ramanand is sect. Of course, now there is no much. I mean to say, people are still influenced. They have some connection with them, and but there is no much. There is some temple there. Previously, it used to be a great monastery and ashram, and then Gurukula. So it was a great center of Ramanandi sect. So now, some once in few one, few times in a year, people nearby villages, they come and do some worship there. Some jatra, something like that. So it's not such a. But anyway, those days it was a very strong hold of Ramanandis, and they made a issue that Gaudiyas are not a proper bona fide, sampradaya. And then king, that time it was Jai Singh II, Savai Jai Singh II. He was a king at that time, and he invited Gaudiya Vaishnavas from Vrindavan to debate on this issue and sort out this issue. The reason behind, it's more of, it's not actually that, oh, they wanted to establish Siddhanta or something like that. It's basically Jai Singh was getting attracted to Gaudiya Vaishnavism because he had visited Vrindavan. He was studying books of Goswamis, six Goswamis, Gaudiya Acharyas. And Jai Singh was a very great scholar. He himself has written many Sanskrit books. He has written books on Jyotisha and many other things. So he was a great scholar. When he was a small boy, just 12 year old, he had visited Vrindavan, and he was studying Gaudiya Vaishnavism and getting attracted. And another point was that how Govinda Dev, which was the original deity of Gaudiyas, Rupa Goswami worshipped and built a great temple for Govinda Dev. That deity was shifted to Jaipur because of Muslim invasions. So then, along with the deity, Gaudiya Vaishnavas also came to Jaipur. So in this way, now Jaipur was built. So Jaipur was a. So in this way, they were little feeling insecure because they will lose the patronage of king. So therefore, they wanted to attack Gaudiya Vaishnavism, Vaishnava Sampradaya. Anyway, by that time, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur was very old. And he called Baldev Vidyabhushan and told him, "You go to Jaipur and sort out with this issue." So their main arguments were there that there are only four sampradayas. How come this fifth sampradaya came? Of course, Gaudiya Vaishnavas are connected with the Madhva sampradaya by initiation, but there are some differences in the teachings. So, but they are acceptable differences. In among all the Vaishnava sampradayas, there are some differences, but we don't have to stress on those differences. Saraswati Thakur, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he said that differences among the Vaishnava sampradayas should not be stressed, but the common goal of Vishnu Bhakti should be emphasized. So in this way, there can be some differences, and especially in terms of rasa vichara, there will be a lot of differences. And this rasa vichara was mainly developed by Gaudiya Vaishnavas. So there, obviously, there will be a lot of differences. Because rasa vichara, without differences, there cannot be rasa vichara. In one sense, even Madhvacharya, he also spoke on differences, right? His main philosophy is what? Jiva and Ishvara is different. Ishvara and Prakriti are different. Jiva, Jiva differences are there. So, and when it comes to rasa tattva, Lord is reservoir of all the rasas, akhila rasamrita murtihi. Krishna means he is reservoir of all rasas. And every living entity has its own rasa with Krishna. So in this way, there will be different rasas. Krishna is not impersonal. So these are all acceptable and they are spiritual. So differences in rasa. So like that. So Lord and his avatars are also different, one and different, simultaneously one and different. He is the same Lord, one Lord, but from rasa point of view, he is different. All the forms of Lord are different from one another. So in that way, we should understand these things. So anyway, they attacked and they had different points. You people worship Radharani with Krishna. Here in South India also, no, we see that Vaishnavas often they say that, oh, Radha was not married to Krishna. How can we worship? Lakshmi was married to Krishna. Therefore, one of the celebrations in a year, main celebration in the temples is Kalyanam. Sita Rama Kalyanam, Lakshmi Narayana Kalyanam. So we can do Radha Krishna Kalyanam because they were not married. That is not the reason actually. Of course, their marriage happened. There is, in some Puranas it is discussed that you know, there is a place also in Vrindavan, one of the places where that marriage, Gandharva, Brahmaji personally came and married Radha and Krishna. That's a different thing. But the main thing is because their relationship, Gaudiyas worship them in Parakiya Rasa. So not Swakiya Rasa. Swakiya Rasa means married queens. So relationship with Krishna or Vishnu is called as Swakiya Rasa. So Gaudiyas worship Radha Krishna in Parakiya Rasa. So anyway, that was their one point. Then there is no Vedanta commentary, therefore it is not a bona fide sampradaya. So because it was a trend in among the Vedic schools that to be a bona fide sampradaya, Vedanta sampradaya, one should have a commentary on Vedanta. So it was a trend from the time of Shankaracharya to write commentaries on Prasthanatraya. So what they consider as Prasthanatraya is 10 important Dasha Upanishads is called Shruti Prasthana, and Bhagavad Gita is called as Smriti Prasthana, and Vedanta is called as Nyaya Prasthana. These are considered as Prasthanatraya. Actually, if you see the literal meaning of Prasthanatraya, it is little broader. Our acharyas gave little broader understanding of that. So prasthana means not only just shruti prasthana means not just 10 Upanishads. All the shrutis are called prasthana, shruti prasthana, and all smritis are called not only Bhagavad Gita are called smriti prasthana, and Vedanta is called as Nyaya prasthana. So prasthana means progressing, advancing towards absolute truth. Traya means three. These are the three means of advancing towards absolute truth. Shruti, Smriti and Nyaya, Vedanta. So we should not take only some portions of the Vedic literatures. That it becomes Ardha Kukuta Nyaya. Some Mayavadis, they even say that Smritis are not equal evidences or pramanas to the level of Shrutis and means Upanishads and Vedanta, they say. So this is called Ardha Kukutanyaya. So our acharyas, they didn't give so much. And moreover, in our sampradaya, Bhagavatam was given highest importance. So therefore, previous acharyas, before Baldev Vidyabhushan, they did not write a commentary on all this Prasthanatraya, Vedanta, etc. So they wrote commentaries and books based on they wrote their own seminal works on Bhagavatam, they wrote commentaries on Bhagavatam. So they focused on Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also, he told, study Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam, it is highest pramana. So in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's sampradaya, it was not given so much importance. Other prasthanatra, Upanishads anyway, they are ABCDs in front of Srimad Bhagavatam. Bhagavad Gita. So even Vedanta also. Vedanta also ABCD. Why? Because Vedanta is just essence of Upanishads. So in Chaitanya Charitamrita it is mentioned that direct meanings of the Vedanta Sutras are given in Upanishads. So that means Vedanta is essence of Upanishads. Basically it is a spiritual knowledge, Adhyatma Vidya. In 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, no, Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam. So among all the Vidyas, I am Adhyatma Vidya. Srila Prabhupada, in that purport, he quotes a verse from Padma Purana. He didn't quote the verse, but he put it as a part of his purport, saying that there are 14 divisions of Vidya. So 4 Upanishads, then 6 Vedangas. 4 Vedas, 6 Vedangas, then there are Dharma Shastras, Mimamsa, Nyaya, then 14th one is Vedanta. So Adhyatma Vidya Vidya, among the 14, what is Adhyatma Vidya? Vedanta is Adhyatma Vidya. All others are just, basically they are Aparavidya, they are materialistic knowledge. So now Vedanta, of course in the Vedas, 4 Vedas, the later portions, final portions of Vedas are Upanishads. Even in Vedas also there are again divisions are there. Samhitas, Brahmanas, Aranyakas. So then Upanishads. So basically Samhitas, they are actually Vedas, Veda Samhita it is called as. We are not just talking about Manu Samhita, Brahma Samhita and all, they are Smritis. Here we are talking about Shrutis, 4 Vedas. So in that Veda Samhitas, so Veda Samhitas are actual Vedas, the Vedic mantras are part of these Veda Samhitas. So Brahmanas are guide to these Veda Samhitas, guide means where these mantras have to be used, which, while performing which sacrifice, which mantra has to be used. So they are guidebooks, Brahmanas. Then Aranyakas are a philosophical explanation of these Vedic mantras. That means they give the meaning of those mantras. They are called as Aranyakas. Why they are called Aranyakas? By reading those, understanding those mantras, we should go to Aranya. We should go to forest. That means renounce everything. Because understanding, after understanding the meaning, we come to know that everything in this world is futile. So then further study of spiritual knowledge is Upanishads. Upanishad, Prabhupada in second chapter Bhagavad Gita, Traigunya Vishaya Vedo Nistraigunyo Bhava Arjuna Nirdvandvo Nitya Satvastu Niryoga Kshema Atmavan. In that verse purport, Prabhupada he says, Upanishads mark the beginning of transcendental life. So Upanishads, they begin actually spiritual knowledge. After renouncing everything, you go to forest and then learn spiritual life. So spiritual wisdom, that is Upanishads. So this essence of Upanishads was kept in Vedanta in the form of sutras. So Upanishads, when commentators write commentary on a Vedanta sutra, each sutra they correlate with certain sections of Upanishads. Like Anandamayo Bhyasat, one of the sutras. It is a 12th sutra in Vedanta sutra. So Balle Vidyabhushan in his commentary, he quotes from that Katha Upanishad, where there is Taittiriya Upanishad. So there is where there is these Annamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, Vijnanamaya and Anandamaya, because the sutra is Anandamayo Vyasat. So these different levels of consciousness are discussed. Actually Taittiriya Upanishad indicates that these are not levels of consciousness which Taittiriya Upanishad. Taittiriya Upanishad describes these Annamaya, Pranamaya, etc. as representations of different forms of the Lord. So that is one understanding. Another understanding is, of course, so below four, below Anandamaya, they are consciousness, conscious levels of the living entities, and Anandamaya is absolute truth. So Anandamayo Vyasat. Actually it is Krishna. Although Vedanta never brings the name of Krishna. But Anandamaya, who is Anandamaya? It is Krishna. Absolute truth is Anandamaya. That is the meaning of Krishna. One whose very existence is full of bliss is called as Krishna. That is definition of Krishna. Krishir Bhuvachaka Shabdo. Bhuvachaka means Bhuvachaka. Bhu. If you see Bhu Dhatu in Sanskrit, it is existence. Meaning of that Dhatu is existence. So one whose very existence is full of bliss, he is Krishna. Krishir Bhuvachaka Shabdo Nastu Nivrati Vachaka Thayo Raikyam Parabrahma Krishna Ityabhidiyate. So why Parabrahma is called as Krishna? Because his very existence is full of bliss, Anandamayo. Anyway, each sutra is, of course, different commentators may connect them to different verses from sections and verses from Upanishads. So anyway, that is Vedanta. So if you compare with Bhagavatam, these are all, Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita and Vedanta Sutra, they are all ABCD in front of Srimad Bhagavatam. Of course, we will also read Bhagavatam, but we don't get even to ABCD. That is a different case. So they basically wrote books and commentaries on Srimad Bhagavatam. They didn't bother. But anyway, Balle Vidyabhushan, he went and debated with them, defeated them, then he stayed there for a long time, Balle Vidyabhushan, in Jaipur, and he became a court pandit of Jai Singh, King Jai Singh, and on the request of Jai Singh, he wrote many books. And of course, that time he wrote Govinda Bhashya also on Vedanta Sutra. So there is one more incident in which is described in by Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Navadvipa Dhamma Mahatmya. There are two khandas in that book. One is Parikrama Khanda. In that Parikrama Khanda, we all know that Nityananda Prabhu took Jiva Goswami to show all the pastime places of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Leela Sthalis, wherever Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates performed. By that time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had disappeared. So Nityanand Prabhu was still there, and Nityanand Prabhu took him to different holy places. Then in Mayapur, in Navadvip area. So at certain point of time, we see that Jiva Goswami expresses desire to write commentary on Vedanta Sutra to Nityananda, to Lord Nityananda. Lord Nityananda says that, no, you don't write it. Gopinathacharya will come back again and he will write, he says. You go to Varanasi, study under Vidya Vachaspati. That time he was just a young boy, Jiva Goswami was. So then he goes to Varanasi, studies under Vidya Vachaspati, all Vedangas, Nyaya, Mimamsa, all these things he studies under him. Why Gopinath Acharya? And so Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he says that this Gopinath Acharya reappeared as Baladeva Vidyabhushan and wrote commentary on Vedanta Sutra called Govinda Bhashya. Now why Gopinath Acharya? If you see, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Jagannath Puri, there was discussion on Vedanta between Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. You all know that incident. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went, and when he saw Lord Jagannath, immediately he fell unconscious. Then all these chowkidars there, security wallahs, they thought that this Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is just madman. But Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya understood that he is a great saint. These are not ordinary symptoms. Sometime you all experience, no? When you go to book distribution, if you go to bank, this that bank manager would be very happy to receive you people, but the security wala doesn't allow you all because he thinks you all are uneducated beggars. Like that he says. It was similar situation here. The security wallahs thought that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is just some madman. So they wanted to beat him and throw him away. Anyways, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, he understood and he took him to his home with the help of his assistants. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was still unconscious. Later his associates, they came and they knew how to awake Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. They did Harinam Sankirtan and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was awake. Then, so before that, there was discussion between Gopinath Acharya and Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. Means among the associates of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who came to Jagannath Puri, one of them was Gopinath Acharya. So he was relative of Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. So he was brother-in-law of Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. So he was a great devotee, but Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya was a Mayavadi. And there was debate, and on the basis of Shastra, Gopinath Acharya established that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now, anyway, later after that, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya even after Gopinath Acharya trying to convince him that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Supreme Lord himself, still he did not accept it. But anyway, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya said to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you are a young sannyasi, you have a long spiritual career, you are very beautiful, you may fall down, you should study Vedanta, because the main thing among the Mayavadis is to study Vedanta. There is a famous statement of Shankaracharya, who is the most happy person in this world? one who has renounced everything, one who has renounced all material happiness, he is the happy person. This is a paraphrasing of that actual Sanskrit statement. Who is the happy person in this world? If somebody asks, or what is happiness in this world? Renounce all happiness of this world, that is the actual. Or one who has renounced all happiness is called as happiest person. So that is what is a philosophy of, or main practice of followers of Shankaracharya. That Sanskrit statement is little different. It is, this is paraphrasing in English actually. So Vedanta Vakeshu Sadaramantaha Kopi Navanta Kalu Bhagyavanta. So who is a fortunate person in Kali Yuga? One who has Kopi Navanta, one who has accepted lion cloth. That means one who has taken sannyas, renounced everything. And one who is immersed in Vedanta Vakeshu Sadaramanta, one should take pleasure in Vedanta Vakya. That is happiness. So, anyway, this was recommendation of, this verse is not quoted by Sarvama Bhattacharya. This verse is quoted, this statement of Shankara is quoted by Saraswati Thakur and Srila Prabhupada in another place in Chaitanya Charitamrita. That is in connection with, in conversation with Prakash Ananda Saraswati, who was another Mayavadi who was defeated by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Anyway, Sarvama Bhattacharya told him, you should study Vedanta. Then I am ready to teach you. So he taught him 7 days continuously. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu peacefully sat and heard and heard and heard. He didn't respond. Then afterwards, Sarvama Bhattacharya said, oh, you did not say anything. You did not ask anything. You did not respond. So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, I understood the sutras, but I didn't understand your explanations. Because those explanations were mostly Shankara's explanations. So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu personally again, Sarvama Bhattacharya was angry and he thought that Shankara Sharirika Bhasha is the Bhasha, is the Vedanta understanding according to Sarvama Bhattacharya. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu refuted all those things and it was a debate, not that only, okay, first Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard and then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu made Sarvama Bhattacharya to hear. That's it. No. It was a debate because Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami explains there, Vitanda Chala Nigrahadi Aneka Utaila Sabakhande Prabhu Nija Mata Sthapila. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he refuted all the different kinds of Vitanda Chala Nigra. These are all wild, very dubious ways of fighting, debating, arguing. Vitanda Chala Nigraha, etc. All kinds of arguments he brought and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu cut them to pieces and established his matha, means his Siddhanta. So anyway, when that conversation and debate was going on, Gopinath Acharya was personally present there. Therefore, he reappeared as Baldev Vidyabhushan and wrote commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam, on Vedanta Sutra, sorry. So therefore Nityananda Prabhu, it was given that service was given to particularly to Gopinath Acharya or Baladev Vidyabhushan. So in this way we see that therefore he is also called as Gaudiya Vedanta Acharya, he wrote. But this is more for preaching purpose. Our main study is Srimad Bhagavatam. Those who believe that Vedanta is the highest, to answer their challenge, this Govinda Bhasha was written. And of course, it is to establish Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as the essence of Vedanta. Establish Bhakti as the essence of Vedanta. Bhakti Vedanta we see, no? So Prabhupada used to say, my name is Bhakti Vedanta. When Mayavadis hear this name, they become surprised. How can be Vedanta can be Bhakti? For them, Vedanta means impersonal jnana or philosophy. Impersonal jnana, philosophy, logic, that's all, nothing else. So there cannot be question of bhakti there. But Govinda Bhasha, with the very name, and this, it establishes Govinda as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So anyway, he wrote, all this story you all know mostly. I particularly wanted to today discuss on works of Bhakti Baldev Vidya Bhushan. He has written many many books, Baldev Vidya Bhushan. Many must be unknown also and lost also. Like he had written commentary on the 10 Upanishads, which was a trend. Shankaracharya wrote commentary on these 10 Upanishads, then Ramanujacharya wrote on this, then Madhvacharya wrote on this, and all the prominent acharyas of different sampradayas wrote. So mostly these are all lost in just, we can see, in just 300 years. A little more than 200 years. So these are all lost. Only Ishopanishad Bhashya is available now. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur wanted to publish these commentaries of Baldev Vidya Bhushan and Upanishads, and he wrote a letter to, from Bengal, he wrote a letter to Goswamis of Radharaman Gera. Radharaman Gera means, you all know that in Vrindavan, that Radharaman temple is there. So the servants of Radharaman Goswamis, and they wrote back to him that only available manuscript which was being eaten by insects, and we have submerged that in Yamuna, like that. So it may be in other places, we may get it, we don't know, somebody has to do research. Although there is one devotee who is doing lot of research in this, especially Baldev Vidya Bhushan's works. So but Ishopanishad Bhashya is there, which was published by Bhakti Vinod Thakur. So then he wrote a book called Aishwarya Kadambini. There is one book called Madhurya Kadambini by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. This is Aishwarya Kadambini. So then there is Kavya Kaustubha. Kavya Kaustubha is an Kavya. Like our Acharyas, they wrote many literature in the genre of Sanskrit language. So Sanskrit linguistics. So like Jiva Goswami, he wrote Hari Namamrita Vyakarna. It's a grammar book, but in connection with Hari Nama, holy names. So similarly, this Kavya Kaustubha, it is a Kavya, it's a book on Kavya, but it is connected with Kavya Krishna, it is connected with Krishna and Bhakti. Then Gopala Thapani Upanishad Bhashya, there is one Upanishad called Gopala Thapani Upanishad. In that Upanishad, Krishna is personally glorified. In fact, we should say that is the most important Upanishad actually. Although Sri Ishopanishad is considered as most important, because in Gopal Thapani Upanishad, directly Krishna is glorified. Krishna name comes there. Krishnaya Sachidananda Rupaya, etc. So Gopal Thapani Upanishad. Why Ishopanishad and other Upanishads became important? Kata, Mundaka, Taittiriya, Chandogya, Brahadaranyaka, they all became, these are out of the 10 Upanishads. So Ishopanishad is considered as most important because Shankaracharya wrote commentary on them, and other acharyas to refute, they had to write commentary. In that way they got prominence. But actually this Upanishad is very important. Anyway, this is available, it is published. Gopal Tapani Upanishad Bhashya. There is one book he wrote, Chandra Loka Tika, which is, it seems it is lost, it is supposedly lost. Then sixth one is Chanda Kaustubha Bhashya. Now this is another in Sanskrit genre. Why? Because Chanda means it's a metrical science. In Sanskrit composition, different meters, you know. There are two divisions in Sanskrit. One is Gadya and one is Padya. So there are no much. Mostly they composed in Padya form. Because it had many advantages. So one is that it can be melodiously recited, and it can be memorized, easy to memorize. So because memorization was very integral, very important aspect of Vedic or Sanskrit pedagogy. So therefore, mostly it was just memorization. So therefore, they wrote in the form of Gadya than Padya. Padya means in a verse form, and Gadya means prose. So they wrote mostly in Padya form, and it also indicated it is a sign of scholarship of an author, actually, you know, if you are writing. So then Chanda becomes very important. Not only that, the main reason Chanda Shastra came into existence is because of Vedic mantras have to be recited in proper chandas. They are composed in proper chandas. So if we don't understand and recite properly, then what happens? Vedic mantras will not give their results. So therefore Chanda Shastra became very important, and it is considered as a basis of Vedic study. So now, originally Chanda Shastra was written by Pingalacharya. Pingalacharya is considered as a avatar of Ananta Shesha. So he wrote Chanda Shastra, and then later many others wrote many books on Chanda. So this Chanda Kaustubha was written by Radha Damodar Goswami. You all remember Radha Damodar Goswami? He was one of the gurus of Baldev Vidyabhushan. So he wrote. So Baldev Vidyabhushan wrote a commentary on this Chanda Kaustubha. Therefore it is called a Chanda Kaustubha Bhashya. Then there is Tattva Deepika. Tattva Deepika is a very small book written by, but of course the content is not small. Small book, basically refuting other philosophies and establishing Bhagavad philosophy. Other philosophies means there are Astika and Nastika philosophies. So first he refutes this Nastika philosophies. What are Nastika philosophies? Bauddha, Jaina, Charvaka, these are called Nastika philosophies. Then Astika philosophies are Sankhya, Yoga, Nyaya, Vaisheshika and Mimamsa. So, and Vedanta, these are called as Astika philosophies. He refutes them one by one. Among the Vedanta, of course we are also part of Vedanta school. Achintya Veda, Veda Tattva Vedanta, although it is not so popular among the Vedic Vedanta scholars. So basically, so Tattva Deepika refutes Mayavadi Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta, then establishes Bhagavad philosophy or Gaudiya philosophy. Then he wrote Tattva Sandarbha Tika. Actually, he wrote all the Tika on all the Sandarbhas, but only now Tattva Sandarbha Tika is available. Others are, it is said that they are lost, but we may get also. Lot of research has to be done. Day by day, lot of, Sanskrit books are getting lost. Even our own Acharya's books are getting lost. Because people are not interested to study, busy earning their belly, satisfying belly, earning their livelihood. So, this Tattva Sandarbha Tika is available. So, he wrote commentary on Jiva Goswami's Sandarbhas. So, Tattva Sandarbha Tika is there. So, Nataka Chandrika Tika, it is also lost. So, this again, Nataka Chandrika, it comes in about dramas. It's a Sanskrit genre again. Then Pada Kaustubha. This manuscript is available, it is unpublished. Pada Kaustubha, anyone can understand what it must be? Again, it is in Sanskrit genre, means about the Padas. There are two kinds of words in Sanskrit. One is Namaja, another is Dhatuja. So, these Padas, words. So, Namaja means those which are born of noun, pronoun, etc. They are called as Namaja. And Dhatuja means those which are born, words which are born from Dhatus, roots. So, like that, there are different kinds of words. So this Pada Kaustubha is there. So why they wrote so many books connected with Sanskrit? Because Balla Vidyabhushan himself said that Sanskrit is a deep bottomless well, he said. Well of nectar, actually. Sorry. Deep bottomless well of nectar. Many places, now also in India, there are wells which don't have bottom. So our Madhusudan Prabhu is reminding Pushkar in Rajasthan, there is a lake there which has no bottom. So like that, there are wells and lakes which have no bottom. Bottom means you can't, if you go dive inside, you won't find the earth there. So they are very deep basically. So similarly, Sanskrit is like that. But of course, our acharyas, they connected everything. Just like Harinama, Vyakarna, he explained in with the help of with the holy names. So Prabhupada says that those who study Harinamamrita Vyakarna, they one side they become pure devotees, and other side they become great scholars also, like that. He says, just by studying. So like that. Tattva Sandarbha, okay, that now Pada Kaustubha was there. Then Prameya Ratnavali. So this Prameya Ratnavali is basically summarizes the debate which happened in Jaipur. So in that he explains our sampradaya, lists all the acharyas' names in sampradaya, because that was the argument, right, of the Ramanandis. Then he says how means Radharani, just like all the avatars, they come from Krishna. Similarly, all the Lakshmis, they come from Srimati Radharani. Radha Tattva he explains there. Then, so like that. So, Prameya Ratnavali takes the scheme from Madhvacharya's Nava Prameyas. Madhvacharya also, his teachings he summarized into nine teachings called Nava Prameyas. So just like Vishnu is Sarvottama, Vishnu is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So like that. So yeah. So Vishnu is the Supreme. So like that there are nine Prameyas are there. So taking those scheme of nine Prameyas, Balde Vidyabhushan wrote Prameya Ratnavali. He explained Gaudiya angle, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, like that. So in this way, that is Prameya Ratnavali. There is another book by Bhaktivinoda Thakur called Dashamula Tattva, which also takes the same scheme. Dasha, 10, why 10? Because Bhaktivinoda Thakur added that Veda is the Pramana. And then there are nine Prameyas are there. Pramana and Prameya. Pramana means evidence. Our way of gaining knowledge, and what is that knowledge which we gain by that pramana, that is called as prameya. So dasha mula tattva, these are the mula tattvas, nine tattvas plus one pramana, total 10 dasha mula tattva. It's basically based on this nama prameyas of so Madhvacharya and Prameya Ratnavali of Balde Vidyabhushan. Then he wrote Brahma Sutra Karika Bhasha is, Karika Bhashas are versified commentaries. So that means Balde Vidyabhushan, he not only wrote Govinda Bhasha, which is a bhasha on, so Vedanta Sutra, he also wrote another commentary, versified commentary. It is called as Brahma Sutra Karika Bhasha. Just like Shastra Yonitvat, Supreme Absolute Truth can be known ultimately known by Shastra. That is the meaning of Shastra. This is third verse of third sutra of Vedanta Sutra. And on that, what Balde Vidyabhushan says, Shastra Gamyam Shastra Kartru. Just one small, it is also like sutra, small verse, one pada. So like that. Shastra Gamyam. Absolute truth can be attained only by Shastra, are known by only by Shastra. And Supreme Lord is also writer of Shastra. It will go against all the many of the Vedanta schools. Madhvas themselves don't accept that God wrote Vedas actually. Vedas are always eternal. But Balde Vidyabhushan wrote Shastra Kartru. God is the writer of Vedas. Maker of the Vedas. That is different understanding of word apaurushayatva. Apaurushaya means our acharyas gave idea that meaning that it's not written by human beings, but that doesn't mean God also did not write it. So like that. Anyway, so Brahma Sutra Karika Bhasha, that is. And on Bhagavad Gita he wrote a commentary called Gita Bhushana. This Gita Bhushana is a, you see, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur had written. Immediately why Balde Vidyabhushan wrote another commentary on Bhagavad Gita? Like I mentioned, no, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur had written commentary on Bhagavad Gita called Sararta Varshini. So again, why Balde Vidyabhushan immediately wrote? I can think of some reasons. One is, one devotee he explained, who who is doing research on Baldev Vidya Bhushan project. After Jeeva Goswami, and so Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur was, he was like Rupa Goswami, he was also mostly into Bhakti Rasa, explaining Bhakti Rasa, which is actually core of our Sampradaya's teachings. But he was not into comparative philosophical debate, you know, comparative philosophical explanation, refuting other philosophies and all this kind of things. So therefore, Baldev Vidya Bhushan, in Bhagavad Gita commentary, if it is more elaborate than, very elaborate than Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's commentary, it refutes Mayava, the left, right, bottom. Another reason, I was just recently I was seeing, there is one famous Mayavadi called Madhusudana Saraswati. He is Mayavad. Actually, he is little enigmatic personality he has. One side he expresses very high devotion, but other side he is a Mayavadi. His work called Advaita Siddhi is very famous among the Mayavadis, among Vedanta scholars, and especially Advaitavadis and followers of Shankaracharya. So he had written a commentary called Gudartha Deepika on Bhagavad Gita. I was seeing, comparing both little bit, not fully, comparing both Baldev Vidya Bhushan's commentary and Gudartha Deepika. We see that Baldev Vidya Bhushan is point by point, he is just refuting commentary of Madhusudan Saraswati. So that means at that time, of course, now also Madhusudan Saraswati is very famous for his Advaita Siddhi book and many other works. He is a famous, we can consider that like in Sri Sampradaya, Ramanujacharya was famous. He is a main founder Acharya. Then after that, Vedanta Desika became a very famous Acharya after some 300-400 years after. So like that, there are many prominent Acharyas. In Madhva Sampradaya, so there is there is Madhvacharya, then after that Jayatirtha, then Vyasatirtha. These three are considered as very famous, very prominent. They are called as Munitrayas. Munitrayas, this word comes, it has some history Panini wrote. Panini's Vyakarna is Ashtadhyayi is very famous among the Sanskrit students and pandits and everyone. People study, not so much nowadays, they have little simpler versions, Laghu Siddhanta Kaumudi and Siddhanta Kaumudi, they study more that one. But for Siddhanta, for Kaumudi is also basis was Panini. So the same sutras they arranged in a different pattern. Anyway, so Panini was a Vyakarnakara. Then Kattayana or Vararuchi wrote Vrittis on this Panini sutras. He is called as Vrittikara, so Vrittikara. Then later Bhashyakara. So Patanjali, you know, Patanjali Yoga Guru, you know, Yoga founder of Yoga Darshana. So he wrote commentary on those sutras, Panini sutras. So there is Sutrakara, then Vrittikara, then Bhashyakara. These three people are called as Munitraya. So similarly, in Madhva Sampradaya, these three are called as Munitraya, Madhvacharya, Jayatirtha and Vyasatirtha. So anyway, like that, in Shankara Sampradaya, Madhusudan Saraswati's name also comes. He is a very prominent after. So there are many There are many Advaitas, scholars, great scholars, like after Shankaracharya, one Vachaspati Mishra was there, very famous. He also wrote commentary on Vedanta. So like that. And then this Madhusudan Saraswati, these are all very prominent personalities. So because his books anyway, they were becoming prominent, it seems that Balde Vidyabhushan wrote commentary on Bhagavad Gita, apart from many other reasons. I am telling, this is one, this could be one reason to refute. So Madhusudan Saraswati, although Madhusudan Saraswati's own commentary is highly, Bhaktivinoda Thakur said about that, it is highly devotional, but conclusions are wrong, conclusion is wrong, he said. So it is very difficult to understand him, Madhusudan, because one side he expresses great devotion, another side all mayavad, full. So whether he is a devotee or whether he is a mayavadi, so that's why I use the word enigmatic personality. So one who cannot be understood. So Madhusudan Saraswati, so it seems that he wrote, so like that, this Gita Bhushana, it's very philosophical, and the style of writing, everything is, the Sanskrit, it's everything is very complex, it is. So to understand, but Bhagavad Gita as it is follows closely this Gita Bhushana. That's why in the beginning Prabhupada, he dedicated Bhagavad Gita as it is to Balde Vidyabhushan. He composed Govinda Bhashya, like that he says. Then Laghu Bhagavatamrita Tika. This Laghu Bhagavatamrita is a book written by anyone knows? Rupa Goswami. Sanatan Goswami wrote Brahat Bhagavatamrita, and Rupa Goswami wrote Laghu Bhagavatamrita. So Balde Vidyabhushan has written a bhashya on that, commentary on that. So then 18th one is Vedanta Samantaka Tika. This Vedanta Samantaka, sometime this book is ascribed to Balde Vidyabhushan. He himself wrote a commentary, but he himself wrote this book. But actually Balde Vidyabhushan did not write that book. It was written by his guru, who? Radha Damodar Goswami. Because Balde Vidyabhushan did not write commentaries on his own books. Sometimes it was done like that. Like Sanatan Goswami, he wrote Hari Bhakti Vilas and he wrote Digdarshini Tikas. They are called as Digdarshini. Often when they write in a very code form, and they explain them how to understand this in their own words, that is called as Digdarshini Tika. Digdarshini means direction to understand, you know, reveals the direction to understand the so the points there. So Digdarshini Tikas, like Jeev Goswami wrote his own Digdarshini Tikas on his own Sandarbhas. So like that, there are Digdarshini Tikas. But Balde Vidyabhushan, he did not write. So, but he wrote Tika on Vedanta Samantaka, means it is, the book is not written by him, it is written by Radha Damodar Goswami. Sorry, Radha Damodar Dev Goswami. Now this Vedanta Samantaka has it explains the five topics: Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Kala and Karma. I have to reconnect, I think.
Network you have to change because data is another network is Redmi.
Okay, there was some network problem. Anyway, this what I was telling, Vedanta Samantaka discusses five topics: Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Kala, and Karma. Vedanta Samantaka, you wanna see there, it is based, it's a book on Vedanta. So basically, book explains that how Vedanta discusses these five topics: Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Kala, and Karma. Now, those who have read Bhagavad Gita as it is, they, we all know that Bhagavad Gita also discusses these five topics of Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Kala, and Karma. So therefore, sometimes I explain that Bhagavad Gita is also Nyaya Prasthana. So generally, Vedanta is considered as Nyaya Prasthana. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he explained in one of the purports to Chaitanya Bhagavata. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur wrote Gaudiya Bhashya commentary on Chaitanya Bhagavat. Chaitanya Bhagavat is book written about, it's a biography of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu written by Vrindavan Das Thakur. So in one of the purports there, or commentary there, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur explains that Bhagavatam is Shruti Prasthana, Smriti Prasthana, and Naya Prasthana, all three. Similarly, we can understand Bhagavad Gita also as Shruti, Smriti, and Nyaya. So why it is Nyaya, Vedanta, Bhagavad Gita? Because it discusses the same five subjects: Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Kala, Karma. Those who have read Bhagavad Gita as it is, they can understand. So similarly, this Vedanta Samantaka explains that how Vedanta Samantaka, you all know Samantaka jewel in Krishna's pastimes. So similarly, so this book like a jewel explains this five topics of Vedanta, and Baldev Vidyabhushan wrote commentary on this book called Vedanta Samantaka Tika. Then Vyakarna Kaumudi, it is lost, it is a book on Vyakarna, just like Jiva Goswami wrote Harinamamrita Vyakarna, Baldev Vidyabhushan also wrote Vyakarna Kaumudi. Then he wrote Shabda Sudha. It is available but unpublished. Manuscript is there. Again, you can understand Shabda Sudha. Means it is Shabdas, it is explaining. It is also in Sanskrit genre. So then Srimad Bhagavata Bhashya. The name of the Bhashya is Vaishnavanandini. So, Vaishnavanandini, it is published, not completely, yeah, it is published, 10th canto is published by Krishna Shankar Shastri, incompletely, not fully. Krishna Shankar Shastri, you all know. Yeah, he is from Ahmedabad, who used to publish these commentaries on Bhagavatam. He has published that 18 commentaries version. Prabhupada used to use that and wrote his own commentaries based on that, using that as a basis. So Vaishnavanandini commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam. Then Shyamananda Shataka Tika. So because Baldev Vidyabhushan came in Shyamananda Prabhu's line, so therefore it is. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur came in Narottam Das Thakur's line. And Shyamananda Prabhu came in. So Shyamananda Shataka Tika. Then 23rd Sahitya Kaumudi. This is published. This is widely studied all over India, Sahitya Kaumudi. In some of the Madhva Gurukulas also they study, I think, this. So this is again about, it is in Sanskrit genre, about Sahitya, literature, Sanskrit literature. So then there is Siddhanta Darpana. Siddhanta Darpana is, it is about in this book Ballai Vidya Bhushan refutes some of the controversies surrounding Srimad Bhagavatam. So like one controversy is Srimad Bhagavatam is not written by Veda Vyasa, it is written by Opadeva. Prabhupada, he mentions that, no, in his own Bhagavatam in the first canto. So Ballai Vidya Bhushan refutes how Srimad by stating that how Srimad Bhagavatam was quoted by even scholars who were even prior to Opadeva. Like that he refutes that point. Like that many things surrounding, all the controversies surrounding this. And most of these books of Ballai Vidya Bhushan were again commented later. His disciples and followers, two of them especially, Nanda Mishra and Vedanta Vagisha, they wrote commentaries on Ballai Vidya Bhushan's books. So because Ballai Vidya Bhushan, he will very briefly, in a very cold way, very complex language, so he would write, and that would be further explained by these two people. So Siddhanta Darpana, I think it is Vedanta Vagisha or Nanda Mishra, one of them have commented on this. And in this book he also refutes, in Madhva Sampradaya they say that these three chapters were interpolated in Bhagavatam. 10th canto, that killing of Agasura, then next chapter Brahma Vimohan Lila and Brahma's prayers, these three, 12th, 13th and 14th chapters of 10th canto of Bhagavatam. They were interpolated in this, in Bhagavatam, they are not actually in original Bhagavatam, like that Madhva Sampradaya people also. So Ballai Vidya Bhushan very strongly refutes that here. So like that. Then Siddhanta Ratna, sorry, that is Siddhanta Darpana. This next book is Siddhanta Ratna. So Siddhanta Ratna is a introduction to Govinda Bhasha. But it was written after Govinda Bhasha. It is called as Govinda Bhasha Pitika. Pitika. Pitika means, you all know, it is introduction. Whatever he could not explain, means in Govinda Bhasha, he further explained them in this. And he also, it also gives basis to understand, enter into Govinda Bhasha. So this was written towards the end of his life. So he was very old that time. So it's a very important book, Siddhanta, quite big book also. Again, it is also commented by one of them. I don't remember, maybe Vedanta Vagisha must have commented on this. So then there is Thavamala Bhashya. This is, Stavamala is Rupa Goswami's book, and he has written commentary on Rupa Goswami. Like this, there are books, there are some books which are ascribed to or attributed to Ballai Vidya Bhushan, but it is not. Sukshma Tika and Govinda Bhasha, it is written by Vedanta Vagesha. Yeah, Siddhanta Ratna Tika is also written by Vedanta Vagesha. Vedanta Samantaka is written by Radha Damodar Goswami. Commentary on Sahitya Kaumudi, it is unknown. Krishna Bhavanamrita Tika, Krishna Deva Sarvabhauma is written. Krishna Bhavanamrita is a book written by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur about Krishna's pastimes. So Prabhupada mentioned that in his Krishna book actually. So we all should immerse in books like Krishna Bhavanamrita, like that he says, Prabhupada. Of course, then he says that, oh, this book, Krishna book, is also, he tells about Krishna book. Then Gupta Dhamma Chatra, it's not, these are all books not written, but they are ascribed to Ballai Vidya Bhushan. Khanai Lal, Gopal Champu Tika, Veerachandra Goswami, it is written by Gopal Champu, you all know, it's a book written by Jeev Goswami on the pastimes of Krishna in Champu form. Champu is one kind of Kavya. Padyavali Tika. Rasika, it's called as Rasika Rangada. You know Padyavali, it is a book written by Rupa Goswami. It is a anthology of verse, Sanskrit verses. Anthology means they are collected from different places and organized in, you know, topic wise. So Veerachandra Goswami has written Tika on that called Rasika Rangada. Balatoshani. Balatoshani is what? Hare Krishna Acharya. This Balatoshani is Balatoshani or Balabodhini it is. Balatoshani, I think, yeah. That is Harinamamrita. Yeah, it's Hare Krishna Acharya. Yes, Harinamamrita Vyakarna. Thika it is. So Samshaya Shatani is Raghunandan Goswami's book. Sadananda Vidyayini Tika. Vrindavan Chakravarti. Stavavali Kashika. Vangeshwar Vidyabhushan. So like this. Anyway, those 26 books are written by Baldev Vidyabhushan. It's a great contribution, great wealth. We are all most unfortunate souls that we don't have. Of course, we have Prabhupada books. They are all in all. And all these Baldev Vidyabhushan teachings are there also in Prabhupada books. In that way, we don't lose anything. Prabhupada books are enough. We can study throughout our life. They can be syllabus for all our life, our spiritual life. They are spiritual, you know, syllabus for our spiritual life. But Krishna is unlimited. Different acharyas have, you know, given drop of that mercy of Krishna and that ocean of mercy of Krishna in their own way. So we have to immerse. One time one Prabhupada disciple, he fell down, he ran away with a woman, and Prabhupada was so disturbed, and he said, why these devotees are not reading my books, he said. And in 10.10, anyone remembers Bhagavad Gita 10.10 verse? Machita Madgata Prana Bodhayanta Parasparam Katayantashama. 9th verse, no, that is. Anyway, one of that verses. Prabhupada, he quotes that. Bhagavata Vaishnavanam Priyam. That verse is there, no? Bhagavata is very dear to Vaishnavas. So Vaishnavas take pleasure in Srimad Bhagavatam or descriptions of Krishna. Just like a young man and women take pleasure in each other's association. So like that we have to immerse ourselves into this Krishna Rasa, Krishna Rasayana. Otherwise we have to get into Bhautika Rasa, materialistic Rasa, which is miserable. There is no Rasa there. Or it is Prakrita Rasa, Ku Rasa, or ultimately it is poison for the soul. So these acharyas have given all these things, but we are not fortunate. We should know Sanskrit, we should know many things, not just Sanskrit, to study all these books. So Prabhupada mercifully he has given. So these are all great contributions of Baldev Vidyabhushan, a very monumental acharya. Today we can pray for his mercy. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Any questions and comments?
Prabhuji, why
Srila Prabhupada dedicated his this Bhagavad Gita book to Baldev Vidyabhushan. Why not to his own guru, Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur?
Because I mentioned, no, in the class, this is not silly question, it is very important. Prabhupada commentary closely follows Baldev Vidyabhushan's commentary. Therefore, he dedicated it to Baldev Vidyabhushan. So, that's the point. If you compare and read, if you see, it is very closely follows.
Another question also, so you quoted 14 divisions of this BTS, will you repeat it later?
You can refer 10.32 Bhagavad Gita Purport. There is a verse called Angani Shatvaro Vedo, like that from Padma Purana. Same verse only, Prabhupada, he has not quoted it, but he has put it as part of his Purport. So, four Vedas, six Vedangas. Six Vedangas are Vyakarna, Shiksha, Nirukta, Chanda, Jyotisha, Kalpa. These are six Vedangas. I'll repeat. Vyakarna, Shiksha, Nirukta, Chanda, Jyotisha, Kalpa. These are six Vedangas, together then 10, then 11th one is Dharma Shastras, Dharma Shastra, Purana is another one, so 12, then Mimamsa and Nyaya, 14. These are 14 Vidyas. So among them, Nyaya, especially this, it's Vedanta Sutra. It may be considered as Purva, Uttara Mimamsa also. Mimamsa, it may come in Uttara Mimamsa. We don't know how they categorize it, but that is Adhyatma Vidya among all of them. Because it is essence of Upanishads. Upanishads mark the beginning of transcendental. Then anything else? I had two topics in mind. One was qualities of Baldev Vidyabhushan, and another was I wanted to focus mostly works of Baldev Vidyabhushan. So today I thought, okay, let me speak on works of Baldev Vidyabhushan. So therefore I spoke more. Other things about his life, I think more or less you all know mostly. So there is one devotee who is doing research. It is called Baldev Vidyabhushan Project. So he is collecting all the works of Baldev Vidyabhushan, going all over India, visiting all the libraries, research centers, and making critical editions of Baldev Vidyabhushan. Critical editions means, you know, in many editions, manuscripts, there will be Ashuddha Pata. Ashuddha Pata means there will be some different readings. Some, while they are scribes, when they are writing, they make some mistakes. And then, so he is thoroughly checking them and making critical editions, and also translating them in English. So it's a huge product, and very efficiently he is doing. In last 10 years, it's exactly today it is 10 years, and he has produced a lot of books on his works. So sometime you all can find that Baldev Vidyabhushan project dot blogspot something it is. Maybe I can send that link to you all. Anything else?
How to get your link directly? Because I got it from Prabhuji, from Dharan.
Acha. You can say one number. Can you tell your number?
93.
93? The title, how this Baldev got.
Baldev Vidyabhushan, I think it was name given, it is title, I actually don't remember now, because he had an initiated name also. I just today morning I read, I just went out of my mind. I'll let you know sometime.